Welcome to tutorial 3 of Methods in Transportation Econometrics and Statistics. In this tutorial, we will do an exercise about the example booking demand in hotels. We already had at the lecture on frequency statistics. So remember, we have 12 hotels. We have two exogenous variables. The quality with the proxy is number of stars, and the price, euro per night. And we have a relative booking rate, occupancy in percent, 0 to 100%, with the following table. So we have 12 hotels, 1, 2, 3, and 4 star hotels with different prices, and also the booking rate, so between 24 and 90%. So a linear regression model is the usual one. Y equals intercept factor quality factor price with associated sensitivities. So pretty simple, no interaction terms, only just the simple factors without any further thing. So at first we should just use the vector matrix notation, specify the vector of the endogenous variable, that means booking rates, and the data matrix of the exogenous factors of the corresponding system equations. So for the vector y, this is just a column vector of the booking rate. So it's a column vector beginning with 42, 38. So this is just this column vector, 42, 38, and so on, up down to 68, which was this. So now about the data matrix. So we have the intercept, and this intercept has a pseudo factor x0 equal 1. So that means the first column of the data matrix has just ones. The second column, it's so it's a column 0, the column 1, and the column 2. Second column has quality 1, 1, 1, 1, 2, 2, 2. And the third, the last column has the price 15, 31, and so on. So let's look. First is just one, then second is just the stars ordered, and the third is the price per night. Of course, the ordering is completely irrelevant. I just have done it in the table, so we can rearrange the table. It will not change anything on the regression, because in a regression, only sums appear, and the sums are, of course, commutative. So that was subproblem A, specify the vector and the data matrix. Now we have got vector and data matrix, then we can determine the ordinary least squares estimator, hat vector beta for the parameter vector. The parameter vector has three components, beta 0, beta 1, and beta 2. And so we need the usual formula. This beta is x transposed x to the minus 1 times x transposed y. This is this one, yes. And now we need to calculate the single components. So first we need the product of a matrix x transposed x. This is the product is just the first, the 0, 0 element. It's just first the transposed, that is this matrix just rotated by 90 degrees. So that we have a column, a row of ones and a column of ones given a scalar product 12. Here we have first in the transposed vector, this is the first row, then the second column, so we have this, so it's just 1 times 1 plus 1 times 1 and so on. Final term is 1 times 4, and that gives 30. This is of course symmetric, because this, so we can leave out the transpose if we just say this is component ij is just the row I scalarly multiplied with a column j. So this is symmetric. the to-do element, we just multiply this column with itself. And so this is a scalar product of this as a row vector times this as a column vector. And that's of course also this. And finally, last element, the to-do element, notice that we start counting with zero, is just this as a row vector times this as a column vector, so the scalar product giving this number. Then we need the inversion. You will not do it in the exam, moreover you will not do it, need to do it inverting a 3 times 3 matrix if it's oral, which is probably will be the same this the case this semester. So you can just say this way it's done, that's a fixed formula. You will not need to do it, so it's just for information. So this is just, this will be the result of the inversion. And then we need also transpose data matrix times the vector of the endogenous variables. So the first is just, because the first is just transposed, it's just the row vector consisting of ones multiplied with this. So this will just give n times y arithmetic average, something 74.1. So this is, and when we multiply scalarly this with this, giving this element, and the last is this and this, giving this element. So, and then we have this inversion of a data matrix transpose times data matrix, and we have this, so we can multiply this with that matrix times vector gives a vector, and this is the final vector of the ordinary least squared estimator of the parameters. So now we come to point C. Now we have the ordinary least squared estimator. Always the first thing is to discuss if the values and the signs of the beta estimators are plausible. First, I did not check beta zero because beta zero is sort of not very intuitive. What would mean the value of beta zero? Obviously, y equals beta zero if the hotel has no stars, x1 equals zero, and also it does not cost. So you can say, so if you have some cheap hole which not any stars but it's free for you, then, and if this is still occupied, it will be have occupancy beta zero. But this can even be negative depending if people take much value for a star. So nobody would take the free but a shitty hole with zero stars. So the other parameters have a meaning. This this is the appraisal for quality for stars. It just gives how many more increases the occupancy if you have one star more. Ceteris paribus, that means if all everything else remains the same. And we have 38.2. The y is given in percent, so that means one additional star at the same price will lead to nearly 40% more occupancy. So it's quite a high value, but it's plausible. Moreover, it's positive. More quality at the same price is more attractive, so this should be positive. It's the other way around with the price sensitivity beta 2. That means, what does it mean? First, it's just the change of a booking in percent per additional euro, because the x2 is just the price per night. And that means if you have 1 euro more, beta 2 gives the change of the occupancy if the price is €1 more, and the quality, that means the star rating is the same. Of course, if something gets more expensive and for the same quality, then it's less attractive, so the occupancy will decrease. So this beta 2 must be negative. It's a quite small value because yes, €1 is also only a small fraction of the price of overnight. So this is reasonable. So that's point C. So we have discussed the values of beta 1 and beta 2. So they are all the values and the signs are plausible. So now we come to point D. Price and booking rate correlate positively with a descriptive correlation coefficient, which is quite high. You can see it here. Obviously, 4-star hotels tend to cost more than 1-star hotels, and so that the 1-star hotels have between 15 and 40 euros, 4-star hotels between 82 and 116 euros. So obviously there's some correlation. So that's quite plausible. So moreover, even the booking rate, that is trivial, but also the booking rate correlates with the stars. Obviously the 1-star hotels only have between 24 and 42 occupancy, while the 4-star hotels have all occupancy above 60 or equal 68%. Does this mean that people love to pay much? Of course not. It's just so that they appraise the rise in quality given by the stars more than the increasing price. It may also be that there's a scarcity of 4-star hotels, so that's also why they choose it in spite of a higher price. It can also be that the location of the 4-star hotels is better. That's, by the way, a missing crucial factor for the attractiveness of hotels. So if you have want to buy a house the most criterion every seller and buyer of houses says is the location, German, die Lage and die Lage are the most the three most important criteria. That of course says the location is very a crucial aspect, which we miss in this exercise. So this, but here, to answer D, the conclusion that people love higher prices is erroneous, because the higher occupancy for the expensive hotel is just that the increased quality matters more than the increased price. So now we can come to point E. So first, the statistics software calculated the estimated variance covariance matrix of the parameter estimators. So it's because the residual variance sigma is also not known, it must be estimated as well. So we can only have the estimated variance of the uncertainties. Notice again the double stochasticity. This beta is of course is a random variable with a certain distribution, but also the parameters of this distribution are unknown, so we have not the real variance covariance matrix V without a hat, but only the variance covariance matrix with a hat. But this can be calculated quite easily from the data matrix, which we learned in the lessons. Now we should do a test at a significance level of 5%. We should test if appraisal for quality is significantly different from zero. That means if it's possible to reject that's the first subtask. The next subtask is to reject the null hypothesis that the price sensitivity is below minus 1.5 percent per euro. In both cases, you can use a t-test using a table for the quantile values. You can also directly use the plots for the appropriate student t distribution below. So this is the distribution, not the quantiles, but the distribution of a student t distribution. The arguments start at 1 because we do not need arguments less. And it's also the appropriate degrees of freedom. How many degrees of freedom? We have 12 data points. And we have 3 parameters to estimate. That means 12 minus 9, 12 minus 3, we have 9 degrees of freedom. So this is the cumulative distribution function, or simply distribution function, of the student t distribution with 9 degrees of freedom. Now this is it. This was the f-test for the next task. This is the distribution of a student t distribution with 9 degrees of freedom. So let's start with the first subtask. Appraisal of quality is significantly different from zero. For this, we need the beta estimator of beta 1, which was the appraisal for stars. And the solution was 38.2. We also need the standard deviation. Here you have to take care to watch. We have a factor 1, but the numbering here starts with 0. So this is the intercept. So we need to take this value. This is the variance of the beta 1 estimator. We need the square root of this, and then we get the t data value. So this is the corresponding t data value. That is the estimator of the star appraisal. That is the cutoff, the null hypothesis boundary, which is 0. And this is the square root of this variance of a beta 1. We get 7.49. And we can, if we have a student t table, we can say we can reject it if t is absolute value is greater than this quantile, which is 2.262, with a rejection. But we can also use the distribution directly. No, it wasn't a solution. We can also use this. This is the student t distribution directly, and see that at 7, which about here, the student t distribution is basically equal to 1. That means here you can see the quantile, 0.95 quantile, that's exactly here. The data value is here, so it's highly significant. It can also be seen with the the p-value. The p-value for this less or equal test is given by this quantile. So this is a quantile that we also have from the lecture. And so it's 2 times 1 minus the student t distribution at the data value. And this is much smaller than 1%. So the next test was, we test the null hypothesis that beta 2, the price sensitivity, is smaller than minus 1.5. That means one additional euro deters at least minus 1.5 percent points of the customers. So again, the test function is student t distributed, where data realization is the estimator for this price sensitivity minus the boundary of the null hypothesis, minus times minus gives plus, And this is the square root of a two element of a variance of covariance matrix. This one giving 2.75. So this is a less a test, a less interval test. That means the rejection region is on the right hand side for very large values, and it's if the test data realization is greater than this 1 minus alpha quantile. Here we can use 1 minus alpha quantile because we have a one-sided test. This is 1.83. The realization is 2.75. That means we are inside the rejection region. That's also here. So we have this is the data value 2.75. So we are here. That means that's also the p-value. The p-value is for the less interval test is just 1 minus the distribution function at the data value, giving about 1 minus 98.5%. That means about 1 to 1%. So it's significant with 1 star, between 1 and 5%. Is the p-value. So finally, we do a simultaneous test. We test the simultaneous null hypothesis that the quality appraisal is equal to 30. That means 1 star more gives 30% more occupancy. And simultaneously, the price sensitivity is only minus 0.5. That means 1 euro more gives minus gives 0.5% less occupancy. We also have already pre-calculated the numerical values of a restraint model. That is a model where only the intercept can be calibrated, because these parameters beta 1 and beta 2 are fixed. When we only optimize the intercept and get the sum of squared errors, this 878, while the full model has 498, of the sum of squared model, the full model. Okay, so let's do it. That means we need to calculate the test function, which is Fisher F distributed under the null hypothesis. The test function is the restrained sum of square errors minus the full sum of square errors, which of course is positive because this was about 800 and this about 500. Then we have in the upper denominator, we have the difference of the parameters to be estimated, 3 minus 1. And in the big denominator, we have just the full sum of squared errors divided by the number of estimated parameters in the full model. And this is Fisher F distributed with 2 numerator and n minus 3. That means 9 denominator degrees of freedom, provided that the null hypothesis is true. So that's so we need just to calculate it, the data value, just insert the data values and get 3.44. As you see from this general expression, the null hypothesis is gets less and less plausible when the t gets higher and higher, because that means the restraint sum of squared errors is much higher than the full sum of squared errors. That means the full model can fit the data much better. And that means the null hypothesis is not very probable, because if it were the null hypothesis is true, then of course there is some improvement, but that's just by chance. That is usually be smaller. That means the rejection region is at the right hand side. So we can just use, as in a previous example, the 1 minus alpha quantile to get the limit. And the 1 minus alpha quantile for the 2 and 9 degrees of freedom Fisher F, that's 0.5. So it's about here. 4.25. So it's above the data value. Here starts the rejection region for t values greater than 4.25. And this is a data value, that means we are not in the rejection region. That means we cannot reject the null hypothesis at 5%. So what is the p-value? That is the limiting alpha value, the limiting significance level, just enabling the rejection. For this, we need the p-value for this less interval test. So this is just, as in a previous example, 1 minus the Fisher cumulative distribution at the data value. That is the data value, this blue bar. And here, if we go here, we have about 0.92. That means 1 minus 0.92 is about 0.08. That means 8%. And that also confirms that we could not reject it at 5%, because the higher the significance level, more likely I can reject, and 8% is higher than 5%. So in conventional interpretation, we could not reject this null hypothesis. Here's just an illustration. That is, this is a simultaneous, so that's the density of the two-dimensional probability density of the estimation errors, for given that the estimator for beta 0 is exactly the sum of squared error value. And here you see this is the two-dimensional null hypothesis, so it is quite outside, but it's still not so outside from the two-dimensional distribution that you can reject it. So that was lecture the tutorial number 3 for the master's course of econometrics. Many thanks.